أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه، ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد، again before I start, just a quick point I would like to remind our brothers, when the imam stand in front of us here, it doesn't matter who is the imam, he is the imam, and all of us, we are asked to follow the imam. إنما جعل الإمام ليؤتم به. إنما جعل الإمام ليؤتم به. إمام, we put the Imam forward to follow him. Even if he is in a different madhab, even if he is, we must follow him. I'm not here talking about the madhab, no, I'm talking about the Imam. Any Imam in front of us, we must obey him. When he in the beginning of the salah say straighten your lines, we must obey him and be in straight lines. When he said switch off your mobile or put the mobile in silent, we must obey him. Same as if he said Allahu Akbar and he would go for ruku', we must follow him and go for ruku'. If he said Allahu Akbar and he went for sujood, we must follow him. When he said switch off your mobile, we must follow him. He said سمعنا وأطعنا, we obey. يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. We must obey Allah سبحانه وتعالى, رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the Amir. The Amir is the Imam. When he said switch off your mobile, we must switch off the mobile. So the one we heard after all this reminder, again, there's someone in the salah, his mobile was on. I don't know, he went off. We should really think about it. From now, we should understand that it is a sin. If the imam said, do this, and we don't follow him, it is a sin. Already we accepted him to be our imam. Halas. Secondly, again, another reminder, because another wedding is tonight there, Salat al-Maghrib and also Salat al-Isha, when the Imam and the Muadhin did Iqama for Salat al-Jama'ah, everyone must follow, must join Salat al-Jama'ah. There is no excuse for anyone to say, I will pray later. He must join Salat al-Jama'ah. Even if he prayed before, even if he prayed before, he must join the jama'ah. This is jama'at al-Muslimin. If he doesn't follow this jama'ah, as I said last night, it is really serious. Some of the imams, some of the ulama, they said you can't say that they are Muslims. If all Muslims are in the mosque and standing for Salat al-Jama'ah, he hasn't got any excuse to be left behind. He must join Salat al-Jama'ah. Jazakumullah khairan. Last week we stopped at the point when Adam alayhi salam, he committed the sin and he ate from the tree. And we know that Adam is a prophet. And the ulama debate among themselves, can the prophets commit a sin? Already there is ijma' that prophets, messengers, never commit any major sins. But they come to the minor sins. Some of the ulama said they might commit the minor sins, but madhahib, ahnaf, shafi'iyya, ismailikiyya, all of them, they said that no, even the minor sins, prophets are ma'sumun. They don't commit even the minor sins. Why? Because we are asked, we've been commanded to follow them. They are uswatun hasana lana. They are the best examples for us. We follow them. So we can't follow them if they are committing a sin. So we can't really say, oh, the prophet commit a minor sin, so I will follow him. No, we can't. So prophets are examples, are role models for us. And this is the difference between a messenger and a prophet. Messenger, he come as a rasul, he came with a message. He came with a message. But the prophets, they are role models. They don't have a message. They follow the message before them. They follow the message before them. So Banu Israel, Musa alayhi salam, he was a messenger, right? But there are many other prophets. We don't know even their names. There are thousands of prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them to be role models. So people, they can imitate them, they can follow them. Right, so this is the point we stopped at. Now we come to the next verse when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. فأزلهما الشيطان عنها فأخرجهما مما كانا فيه وقلنا اهبطوا بعضكم لبعض عدو ولكم في الأرض مستقر ومتاع إلى حين. فأزلهما الشيطان. شيطان إبليس لعنه الله. He deceived Adam and Hawa. أزلهما in a dual form in language, linguistic. أزلهما come from deception, misguided them, misled them. أزلهما الشيطان عنها عن الجنة. So Iblis, as we know, it was the first sin because of his arrogance. So because of his jealousy, after that, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed him, so he start to see how come Adam will be honored and Iblis was cursed. So he start to deceive Adam. He tried hard. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him not to come close to this tree, not to eat from that tree. Iblis, la'anahu Allah, he started to ask Adam. أزلهما الشيطان عنها فأخرجهما مما كان فيه. So he deceived them, misled them, to take them out from the Jannah, to let Adam to commit the sin. And here quite a few points. Number one is, as we mentioned, this is shaitan. I want the brothers just to listen carefully about this point. When we said shaitan, Iblis, we must remember that Iblis doesn't have any authority. In many other surahs, inshallah, we'll come to the Shaykh, inshallah, we'll cover this, Surah Al-Isra, Al-Hijr, you'll find Iblis, la'natullah alayh, he doesn't have any authority upon son of Adam. That's why on the day of judgment, he will say that, وَمَا كَانِ لِي عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِلَّا أَنْ دَعَوْتُكُمْ فَاسْتَجَبْتُمْ لِي. Iblis, he will have خطبه. ده سؤال علماء. دي سيد ابليس ان جهنم هي ويل ستاند اند هي جيف ا خطبه. ابليس ويل تيل بيبل ان الله وعدكم وعد الحق ووعدتكم فاخلفتكم. الله سبحانه وتعالى promise you the true promise and I deceived you. وما كان لي عليكم من سلطان. I didn't have any authority upon you. إلا أن دعوتكم فاستجبتم لي. Just I call you and you followed me. فلا تلوموني. Don't blame me. Blame yourself. ولوموا أنفسكم. ما أنا بمصرخكم وما أنتم بمصرخي. I can't help you. You can't help me. So this is the point that Iblis and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another surah said, إن عبادي ليس لك عليهم سلطان. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that because Iblis he said, لأغوينهم أجمعين إلا عبادك منهم المخلصين. I will deceive all of them except. And in linguistic, in Sharia, exception is few. Normally, the exception will be little. So he said, everyone prayed except the people who were in the wedding. You know, so you'll see the mosque is full, but apart from someone who's and waiting for the food, right? So the exception will be the few. So this is, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to Adam alayhi salam, on the day of judgment, أخرج بعث النار. Come to take out your offsprings who are for deserving Jahannam. Who are they, Ya Allah? Who are they? He said that from each 1,999 will go to Jahannam and one will be saved, go to Jannah. So just imagine like this. On the day of judgment, you will see that people holding, getting their books, 999 getting the books with the left hand. Only one will get from the right, with the right hand. People are passing the Sirat, 999 full in Jahannam. Only one pass. Every 1,000, only one. Imagine if you are in the exam, or you have a school, 1,000 students in the school. And the head teacher said, listen, this year, this 1,999 will fail. Only one will pass the exam. Think, if you want to be successful, if you want to succeed, what are you going to do? You are in dunya like that. That's why Sahaba, they were scared when they heard this from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Allah, 999, what are we going to do? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave them a glad tidings. Allah, inni la arju an takun rub'a ahli al-jannah. This ummah, although we are the last ummah, we are really few among the other umam, among all other nations, but yet we're going to be, he said, you're going to be one quarter of the people of Jannah. Then Sahaba said, Allahu Akbar. Then Rasulullah said, Inni la arju an takun thuluth ahl al-Jannah. Inshallah, I hope that you're going to be one third of the people of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. I hope that, inshallah, you will be half of the people of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Then the last, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنِّي لَأَرْجُوا أَن تَكُونُ ثُلُثَا. إِنِّي لَأَرْجُوا أَن تَكُونُ ثُلُثَا أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. Two-thirds of the people of Jannah. Sahaba, they did takbir. People who go to Jannah, they're going to be 120 rows. 80 of them will be Ummat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the big glad tidings. Come back to the point is what? Think about this. Iblis doesn't have any authority. He said, "Illa ibadaka minhum al-mukhlasin." I'm going to deceive all of them except your sincere servants. Ibadaka al-mukhlasin. And there is mukhlasin and mukhlisin. Mukhlisin, the sincere. Mukhlasin, the people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choosing them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will choose the righteous people. So we need to show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala our sincerity, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do istifa, yastafi, choose you to be among those who are the righteous people. Illa ibadak. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إن هذا هذا صراط علي مستقيم إن عبادي ليس لك عليهم سلطان. So there is no authority for Iblis upon the sincere, the true Muslims. The main point is there is no authority. Only he do waswasa, whispering. He come to you like the one who said that, Ya akhi, come to pray. Insha'Allah, if Allah will, I will pray. So Ya akhi, Allah will. Allah ask you, Allah command you to pray. Come to pray. What can I do? Shaitan. Shaitan? Shaitan doesn't, he doesn't grab you and put you on the floor. Say, don't go to the mosque. Get up, go to the mosque, go and pray and see who's going to stop you. Don't get an excuse, say, Shaitan. Shaitan doesn't have authority. Shaitan just whisper to you, listen, a bit later, don't worry. You'll pray, but a bit later. Okay, do finish this first. You know, even if you are in the shop or you are serving your customers, sudden from Shaitan, deception, هذا الغرور, fitna, a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The man, he will sitting in his shop, no customers. At Salah, lots of customers will come. Then Shaitan says, okay, finish this and we'll go pray. Finish this. Then until he will miss the Salah. Or in Salat al-Fajr, Naam, alayka laylun tawil. Don't worry, you will pray just 2 minutes, 2 minutes, 2 minutes until you'll find sunrise. So it is waswasa. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear. He is waswas. Khannas. This is the characteristics of Shaitan. Iblis doesn't grab anyone from his neck and stay here. Never. Shaitan has two characteristics. Waswasa and he is khannas, very weak. When you see A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem, you shrink, getting very weak. But if you don't, he will become stronger. Every time you do ibadah, you getting more stronger. Your spirit, your soul become really strong. Every time you do dhikr, the heart will be sparks. Every time you have more Quran in your heart, you more dhikr, your heart will be enlightened. Sparks. Shaitan doesn't come close to it. It depends. Some of us, the heart is some light, some darkness. Sometimes really, mashallah, he's really conscious, like in Ramadan, everyone, subhanallah, active. Everyone fasting, recite Quran, tahajjud, taraweeh, mashallah, mashallah. Maybe we find the brothers only sleep 2 hours every day, but still they are really, mashallah, very strong. Why? Because the spirit is really strong and the body is weak. And some other time, you'll find the brother is really very heavy. Why? Because his strength, the body, and he weakness, the spirit. Depends on the heart, how much the darkness, how much the light. Umar ibn Khattab, his heart is full of light. The light is sparks. Shaitan can't come close to Umar. Ya Umar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that, إذا سلك ابن الخطاب طريق سلك الشيطان فجا غيره. Whenever عمر الخطاب just and take one way, شيطان take another way. He can't even come close to the same road, the same street. Why? Because عمر his heart sparks. He can burn شيطان. Some others, the heart is dark. علماء say this is the bed and breakfast of Shaitan. He come and sleep. He is relaxed in his heart. Every time son of Adam commit a sin, one black dot until the heart become really black. Kalkuzi mujakhia, upside down. He doesn't know what's right, what's wrong. Shaitan is sleeping there. Shaitan doesn't have any authority. Shaitan only do waswasa. How to get rid of this, how to avoid it, how to protect yourself with the dhikr. Come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kathrat al-sujood, salah. The Quran and dhikr. This is your arms. That's why they call it hisn al-muslim. The fortress. You protect yourself. Shield. You, this is with the dhikr. So this is the point here, that shaitan doesn't have any authority. So that's why he couldn't. Do you think shaitan, Iblis, he went to Adam and Eve and take them out from Jannah? No. Did he get the tree, the fruit, and said, Adam, you must eat this? No. He whispered to Adam. Adam was strong. He couldn't. Then we'll see what he did. He went to Hawa. How did he get into Jannah? أخرجهما, the next point is أخرجهما مما كانا فيه. So he take them out from Jannah. Take them out from Jannah because he was jealous. How come I've been checked out from Jannah and still Adam there? He, because of this jealous, this envy, he want to take them out, and he did. How? He didn't take them out physically. He whispered to them until the commit the sin, so they can't stay in Jannah. They came out with the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah will for that. Ulama, they said, what exactly did he send the message to them? Did he talk to them face to face? Some of the ulama said yes, because in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقَاسَمَهُمَا إِنِّي لَكُمَا لَمِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ. He did an oath. He gave them qasam. By Allah, I'm advising you, eat from this tree, you will be here in Jannah for eternal. This eternity, just to eat from this tree. You will be there as a king, as a'udhu billah, as Allah. You know, look at this shaitan, Iblis, la'natullah alayh, he made this. And some other said, no, what he did, he went through, and he went to Jannah. He couldn't, because already Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala checked him out from Jannah, cursed him. He went to get in to speak to Adam, to speak to Hawa. Every time he tried Ridwan. Do you know what's Ridwan? Who's Ridwan? Ridwan Khaz in Jannah. This is the angel of Jannah. Malik for Jahannam. That's why kuffar in Jahannam, they say, وَقَالُوا يَا مَالِكُ لِيَقَضِ عَلَيْنَا رَبُّهُ. Oh Malik, please ask Allah to let us die in Jahannam. So Malik ignored them for 1,000 years. Then after 1,000 years in Jahannam, he said, قَالَ إِنَّكُمْ مَاكِثُونَ. You will stay. So Malik, Khazin Jahannam, Ridwan, this is the angel of Jannah. So every time Iblis want to get in Jannah, Ridwan stopped him. So what he did? The snake. Snake was the servant of Adam. The snake was huge with four legs like the camel. And it was really beautiful animal. Really, it was the best animal. So what he did? Iblis, la'natullah alayh, he asked the snake, please, can you let me be in your mouth and just get in? I want to get in. This hikmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wisdom from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the snake allowed Iblis to be in the, Imam al-Tabari, he mentioned also this in his tafsir. Iblis hide himself in the mouth of the snake. Then they get in. From the mouth, he start to whisper to Hawa until she ate from the tree. Then she came to Adam, see, I ate, nothing happened to me. You eat until he ate. Then subhanallah, فَبَدَتْ لَهُمَا سَوَآتُهُمَا. Then they become naked. The awrah wasn't really appeared before. Now, awrah start to be exposed. Then Adam, he felt shame. He tried around, ask anything just to cover his awrah. He asked the trees. All trees escaped from him except the fig tree. Offer him the leaves and he start to cover his awrah. That's why we have enmity to the snake. Snake is our enemy and we are the enemy of the snake. Always like that. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in many hadith, in hadith even Sahih Muslim, he asked Muslims to kill the snake even if you are in the haram. You know, in the haram, in Mecca, you can't really kill any animals. You can't kill any insects except five of them. The snakes, scorpion, the black bird, the rat, and al-hada'a. Al-hada'a, it looks like the falcon, but this, it's not really, it's not here. It's in our back home, comes to eat the chicken, take the, no, the eagle is big. It looks like falcon, but could be. So this is the five. If you see them even in haram, you kill them. Even if you are in salah, if you see a snake or a scorpion, kill it, and it doesn't break your salah. So this is, that's why even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that the snake is kafir, an enemy to you. If you kill this enemy, it was going to be in Jahannam. If you kill this enemy, it's to be a protector from you from Jahannam. Because Rasulullah said that you and your enemy, you will never be together in Jahannam. If you kill him, he will be in Jahannam, you protect yourself. خلاص. لا يجتمع المؤمن لا يجتمع الكافر وقاتله في النار. There is a kafir, enemy to the Muslims, and the Muslim, they fight them and he kill them, he will not be with him in Jahannam. So this is even in another hadith said, if you kill a snake, you will get 50 rewards, some said 70 rewards. If you kill it from the first hit, if you need another two hits, you'll get less than 50 rewards. Third one, less than that. So the Prophet ﷺ, he encouraged us to be courageous, and because even in another hadith, Rasulullah ﷺ said that the one who gets scared from the snake, he is not apart from my ummah. Yeah, this is there is some other points about this, because they say that the jinn themselves, there are some of them are snakes and dogs, some of them are insects. So inshallah we'll come to this point in a minute. So they said that the snake is, the snake was a servant of Adam. After that betrayed Adam, it will take Iblis inside, so the snake betrayed Adam, become an enemy to Adam. There is some hadith, Ibn Mas'ud, he narrated this, he said, we were with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a cave. Then Surah Al-Mursalat was just revealed, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was reciting Surah Al-Mursalat freshly, just once it was revealed. Then they saw a snake, so they ran to kill it. Then the snake went to a hole. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, get fire and put it in the hole. So that means he tried and he really his best to kill the snake. Give a message that it is really our enemy. And Ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah Ibn Mas'ud, he said that hadith marfu' and the Prophet said, "Uqtulu al-hayat kulluhun." You should really kill any snake. There is some, now they said, some snakes you will find it, it's not here, by the way, back home. Sometimes you find in some village, sometimes you find the snakes in the house. Yeah, here the Prophet ﷺ said, if you find a snake in your house, give them a chance for 3 days. Talk to them. Say, we remind you the contract, the oath. Nuh alayhi salam, Sulaiman alayhi salam made this for the snakes, not to harm people, not to harm Muslims. Then because there is some snakes are jinn but became Muslims. Some of the ulama said, no, this only in Medina. This only was in Medina because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, وَإِذْ صَرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ نَفْرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ يَسْتِمِعُونَ الْقُرْآنِ فَلَمَّا حَضَرَوْهُ قَالُوا أَنْصِتُوا فَلَمَّا قُضِيَ وَلَّوْا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِمْ مُنذِرِينَ. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed even Surah al-Jinn. Inshallah, when you come to Surah al-Jinn, you'll find this in details. We covered this in Fath al-Bari, if you remember, in volume number 6. When we talk about Bid al-Khalq, the creation, and then we talked about the jinn, and we mentioned all of that, if you can remember, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he was with him, and he said to him, stay here. I can't remember Abdullah Mas'ud or Abu Hurairah. He made a line, a circle, and he said, stay here, don't move. I don't want you to be harmed. And he went. The Sahabi said that, I saw birds coming to the valley. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went to the valley, and he said, I was really scared. I was really worried about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He stayed there until Fajr, and he came. He said, some jinn Muslims came to me and they asked me to go and give reminder for them to recite Quran for them. So some of jinn in Medina, they are in the form of snakes. If you see a snake in your house, don't kill it straight away. Give them a chance for 3 days. If you see them again, kill them. They are kuffar. They are jinn. Shaitan. Because jinn could be a Muslim, could be shaitan. This is a difference. Remember, shaitan is a general name for the one who disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Could be human, could be jinn. Jinn could be a Muslim or could be shaitan. Insan, human, could be a Muslim, could be shaitan. Shayateen al-ins wal-jinn. Yeah, shayateen al-ins wal-jinn. There are shaitan from human, even some shaitan from human are much worse than the shaitan of jinn. You know, you remember the poet, he said that, وَكُنْتُ جُنْدًا مِنْ جُنُودِ إِبْلِيسِ فَارْتَقَى بِيَ الْحَالُ فَصَارَ إِبْلِيسُ مِنْ جُنْدِي. I was one of soldiers of the Iblis army, but now I become much worse than Iblis. Iblis is one of my army. You know, the some shaitan of human are much worse than the jinn. So come back to the point is, some jinn are Muslims, some jinn are shaitan. So the Prophet said, give 3 days for them. If they stay, that means you can kill them. We mentioned also this story when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was digging the trench in Confederate battle. There was one young man. He asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam permission to go back to his home. And when he went back to his home, he found his wife out of the door. Then he got really jealous and said, "Why she is there?" And he was about to attack. He said, "Don't be patient. Go get inside first and see what the reason why I came out like that." He went and he found huge snake on his bed. So he took the rumh and he hit it. Then suddenly they found some other snakes came and killed the Sahabi. So they were really, they said that, we couldn't know what happened, and they asked the Prophet and he said, go and bury your brother and remember that some of these people, that some of these snakes are jinn and some of them are Muslims. Some of ulama said, oh, maybe when he killed that snake it was Muslim and the others came to do qasas, so that's why they killed this Sahabi. Ulama said, no,
there is no qasas between human and jinn. And also, that man, he doesn't know that this one was a Muslim, this jinn. Another time, Aisha radiallahu anha, she killed a snake. Then she saw in the dream that they said that you killed a Muslim, jinn Muslim. So in the morning, she gave sadaqah, like the ransom, 12,000 dirham. And even she freed some slaves. Sa'd ibn Ubadah, this Sayyid al-Khazraj, the master of Khazraj, tribe of Khazraj. Sahaba, they said they found him in the bathroom, dead. And his body was really, you know, green or bluish. So they said that they heard some, the jinn were to say, they said that we killed the master of Khazraj. We killed the master of Khazraj. So some of them, but I don't want people to get this, oh, maybe the jinn can kill anyone. It is not. Just we mentioned in the beginning that they don't have any authority. And remember that, subhanAllah, you have the sharp arm. Ya akhi, once you say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim, they can't stay there. If you recite Al-Ma'udhatin, Iblis himself, what he did say to Abu Huraira. He came to Abu Huraira for 3 days. Every night come to him, Abu Huraira, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, look after this dates. This is sadaqat, the zakah. Came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was about to distribute them. And he, Abu Huraira, look after this, guard this dates. So Iblis came in the form of a man, and he was about to steal the dates. And he caught him, said, I'm going to give you, take you to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Please, I have children, I'm really poor. So he left him. Next day, he did the same. Third day, and every day, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking Abu Huraira, what happened to your, the one you arrested him last night? What? Then he gave him what happened. Then the last day, he said, I will never leave you. He said, listen, I will teach you something to do. If you say, recite it, never, none will harm you. None will harm your house, whatever you are, your properties. He taught him Ayat al-Kursi. Iblis taught Abu Huraira to recite Ayat al-Kursi at night. He said, if you recite Ayat al-Kursi at night, nothing will harm you or your family or your house, whatever. Then when Abu Huraira narrated this to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Sadaqaka wa huwa kadhub. He told you the truth, although he's a liar. So Ayat al-Kursi will protect you. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajim, protect you. Ma'udhatin, protect you. You are strong with the Quran. If you leave dhikr, you will be very weak. Then blame yourself. طيب the next is, you just there are five animals also. I want to just in another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that khams fawasiq yuqtalna fil hilli wal haram. There are five animals, you kill them either they are in the Mecca or outside Mecca. Hil, haram. Haram is Mecca. Hil, which is you are allowed anyway to kill them, but haram, you are not allowed to harm any animals. Yet, if you find one of these five, you can kill them. Number one is al-hayya, the snake. Number two, al-waza, the lizard. Why? As you know, if when we talk about the stories of the prophets in volume number 5 in Fath al-Bari, we talked about Ibrahim alayhi salam, when they put on the fire all animals, they were trying hard to destroy the fire, except the lizard was blowing the fire to be stronger. So now who was that? The lizard, you could kill it. And the rat, as we said before, and the crown,
طيب the next verse is Allah سبحانه وتعالى said وقلنا اهبطوا بعضكم لبعض عدو. We said come down, descend, you be enemy to each other. Right. You will be enemy to each other. اهبطوا. This verse, this word in Arabic in a plural form. Who are they? They said they're going to be Adam, Hawa, Eve, and the snake, and Iblis. They will be enemy to each other. Some ulama, they said, no, this was for Adam and Hawa, but they said that you, human, you will be enemy to each other. Ulama said, although the meaning is true, lots of humans are enemy, even yourself, within yourself, every day, the organs blame each other. The organs blame each other. If the hand steal the other organ, said, why you steal? You want to put all of us in Jahannam because of you, like that. So they're going to be enemy of each other. But actually, no, it's اهبطوا بعضكم لبعض عدو. Adam, Hawa, and Iblis, they are enemy to each other. And some other ulama said, no, the offsprings of Adam and the offsprings of Iblis, they will be enemy to each other. And they said that Adam alayhi salam, when he descended, he was coming to India. And when he descended to India, he came with lots of perfumes and smells of Jannah. That's why they said most of the perfumes come from India. And all herbs, most of the herbs, all of them in India. Because he was descended in India. Hawa was descended in Jeddah. And the snake was descended in Bisan in Maru. You know, in Palestine now, they call it Bisan. Even now, Bisan is another name of the snakes. Some others said, no, it was in Khurasan. There is one place there, they said, it's full of snakes. Yeah. And they said, even when Adam was descended, the cloud touching his head, so he became balded. That's why only the brothers, they be like me, they become bald. You know, but not the sisters, not Hawa. When Adam was descended, the cloud was touching his head, so the hair gone, and he became balded. But Hawa, not. But Hawa, because she ate from the tree, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Hawa, you will be as you did this, as you cut the fruit from that tree. The tree said, as you and you did bleeding for me, Allah will let you bleeding every month. And when you give a birth, you will be about to die many times. And you can see now what happened to Allah. Even some other, but I don't want to say this, otherwise the sisters will do it. But this is what they said. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you will become Safiha, and before you being Halima, you were really wise before, but because you did this, you will become a bit of, you know, I know this many sisters, they will challenge, they will debate, so we are much more clever than the boys. As all schools, they said, we have a proof that the girls are ahead of the boys, and this is something maybe for something as one particular aspect, but in general, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that. In shahada, they have emotions. Sometimes, even subhanAllah, we need to understand the sisters. Sometimes they talk, but their mind somewhere else. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَنْتَ ضِلَّ إِحْدَاهُمَا فَتُذَكِّرَ إِحْدَاهُمَا الْأُخْرَى. Sometimes because of the emotion, they forget. So maybe that's why you need two witnesses from the sisters, but one witness from the man. I will stop here for this sister. I don't want, because if we want to talk about sisters, we have to make it in a comprehensive way, otherwise we want to be blamed. طيب. الله سبحانه وتعالى سيد ولكم في في الأرض مستقر ومتاع إلى حين. You will be in the earth and you will enjoy the earth here إلى حين, for a such time. حين here in Arabic is a time. But what does mean here حين? Different opinions. It's not here, but in another books about Ali ibn Abi Talib and Umar al-Khattab, they were talking about al-heen, and they look at the Quran, they found Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using this word in different verses for different time. When فَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ حِينَ تُمْسُونَ وَحِينَ تُصْبِحُونَ حِينَ تُمْسُونَ وَحِينَ تُصْبِحُونَ, in the morning and the evening. That means the time short, few hours, half of the day. And in another verse, تُؤْتِي أُكُلَا كُلَّ حِين, Surah Ibrahim, تُؤْتِي أُكُلَا كُلَّ حِين. They said either every the trees give the fruits either every 6 months or every year maximum. And here they said that no, this is up to the day of judgment. إِلَى حِين, for a time up to the day of judgment. That's why this debate? Ulama, may Allah bless them. You can see now we are benefit from those people. Up to now, we learning from Qurtubi, from Bukhari, from Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, Ibn al-Qayyim, Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, Malik, Ahmad ibn Muhammad. All these ulama, subhanAllah, they were spending all the time to think for us to benefit from that. Why? Because what if someone gave an oath, said, by Allah, I will not eat so and so, or I will not talk to you, or I will not go to that house, إلى حين, and for a حين. What حين then? What time? For how long he should really do this to fulfill his qasam? So Imam Shafi'i, he said, we take the minimum. Imam Shafi'i said, we take the minimum. What's the minimum? He said, the minimum is the time which you need to pray the little amount of rak'ah. And the little is rak'at al-witr. By the way, Imam Shafi'i, in his madhab, you could pray rak'at al-witr only one rak'ah. So you could pray four rak'ah Isha, then you pray only one rak'ah witr, that's it. You could do qiyam al-layl only one rak'ah. Even one of the Shafi'i alim, he want to give an example. What he did, he prayed tahajjud only one rak'ah with one verse, and the shortest verse. Do you remember what is the shortest verse? Anyone? One, the shortest verse. One word. Mudhammatan. This is one verse. Right. And he recites only this verse, and he went for, just to give an example, people said, listen, you could pray only one rak'ah witr with the shortest verse. And he said, so Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, if you give an oath, khalas. Someone he can just give qasam for his wife ila heen, for a time, but this time is heen. Which heen? So Imam Shafi'i said, this is the shortest. Imam Malik said, no. The minimum nafl you could pray is two rak'ah. So this is the time. So here I will just give you this, and to be exactly, فَمَنْ نَذَرَ أَنْ يُصَلِّي حِينًا فَيُحْمَلْ عَلَى رَكْعَةٍ عِنْدَ. Someone said, I will give an oath, I'm going to pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a heen. Someone said, oh, that means you're going to pray for 1 year there, or you're going to pray from now until you die. So no, Imam Shafi'i said you could pray one rak'ah, Imam Malik could pray two rak'ah. أقل مالك وأصحابه أقل النافلة two rak'ah. Malik said no, the minimum is two rak'ah. Again, for any, Imam Abu Hanifa توسط فقال 6 months. If someone give an oath, I will not do this for a heen, the minimum is 6 months.
same dahr also as a time you could use it for a 6 month like this. طيب here I'm just 5 minutes inshallah. The next verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said فتلقى آدم من ربه كلمات فتاب عليه إنه هو التواب الرحيم. Adam عليه السلام he received few words and he recited these words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept his repentance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him. Because as we mentioned this before, the difference between our sin and the sin of Iblis, the difference between the sin of Adam and the sin of Iblis, big difference. The sin of Adam came out of the nature of a human being, the weakness of the human being. Don't eat, so he likes to eat, he likes to stay in Jannah, and Iblis deceived him. So out of his weakness. That's why when he commit the sin, look what he did here. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. This is what Adam he said. So he admit, he regret, ask Allah sincerely to forgive him. So Allah forgive him. But the sin of Iblis was out of arrogance, pride. Why should I do sujood for Adam? I'm stronger than him. So he refused. Ulama took this example to differentiate between which one is worse. Think about this. Which one is worse? To commit a forbidden action or to stop to do fard. Usually the sharia is what do, don't do. Sharia is what do, command to do, pray, fast, pay charity, zakah, do hajj, be dutiful to your parents, be with a good manner. This is do, commands to do fard. And there is haram, don't do this, don't commit the adultery, don't drink the wine, don't kill the right. Ulama said, which one is worse? To stop doing the fard or to commit the forbidden action? After long debates, they found if you don't do the fard is much worse than to commit the. Why? Because they said, take an example. Salah. Pray. No, I won't pray. Don't commit adultery. No, I will commit it. This major sin. Don't drink wine. I will drink the wine. They said this is a major sin and Allah could forgive this major sin. There is a way to, even if you commit it, there is a way to be forgiven. Either to do hajj, sincere tawbah, like this. But if someone said, no, I will not pray. Ulama said, no, now he will become kafir. He's not a Muslim. He will not be forgiven. He will not be forgiven. So, and they take the example of Iblis and Adam. Adam, don't eat. He ate. Then he wrote, oh, please, Allah forgive me. Admit regret and sincerely ask Allah. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah forgive him. Iblis, do sujood. No. I'm stronger than him. Why should I do sujood? Then Allah cursed him and he is mal'un now. You get the point? So be careful. Someone, he said, I'm a good man. I'm very good characters. Alhamdulillah, I never harm anyone. I never drink wine. I never commit any sin. I never. So I'm a good man. But why don't you pray? No, pray. You know, brother, many people are praying, but they commit the sin. You know, many brothers, you know, you can see them, they are looks practice and they do this and mashallah, they pray and they are memorizing Quran and they pray every time, but they commit the sin. I'm much better than them. We said, no. To commit the sin is a weakness. I don't say Allah will forgive. Yes, Allah will forgive if you are sincerely ask Allah forgiveness and repent. But to say I'm much better than him even if I'm not praying, no. It is not. Big difference between someone, he said, I'm a very good manners. How you will be good to everyone and you are not good to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How if someone at work, please can do this? Yes, your boss, do this. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, pray. Okay, I will think about it. It's a big difference. How you respect everyone and you don't respect your creator. If someone give you, do you a favor, you would be really grateful every time. Thank you, thank you. Imagine if someone give you a job. So every time you see him, thank you very much. You know, you are, and you tell everyone, this is the one who give me this good job. You know, you tell your children, you tell your family, you know all what luxury we are in now because this man, he gave me a good job. And you forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You never talk to your children, never talk to your family. How much Allah give you? You don't know how much Allah give you? You didn't show Allah how grateful you are? You never show your children, say, listen, remember that we must be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one. Imagine, ya akhi. Subhanallah, there is some ulama, they tried to make a bit of an example for people who are in need of a kidney or they are in need to, you know, dialysis. Maybe his hair NHS is free. In some other country, you have to pay. You have to pay. Even if someone is really can't really breathe well, they give him the oxygen and they charge him. Said now, they try to calculate how much you need every day. Like now we are breathing all the time. If someone is going to charge you, how much are you going to pay? Look at this. We don't remember this. We don't tell our children. We don't tell. Said, oh, people, whatever we, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ, whatever we are enjoying from Allah. Say this to your children. Say this to your family. Remind yourself. Remind all. And remember that everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must do our best to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to show Allah our gratefulness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to do this. There are quite few words. They said what the words Adam, he mentioned. I would just quickly. They said that one of them, they said, no, it's لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. Some other, they said, لا إله إلا أنت عملت سوءا وظلمت نفسي فتب علي إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. They are different, but all of them the same meaning. Oh Allah, just give لا إله إلا أنت. First, you give the word, the كلمة طيبة, كلمة التوحيد. Then you admit that I commit a sin. ظلمت نفسي. I did ظلم against myself. فاغفر لي. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, and accept my repentance. Ulama, they said, yes, we could do the tawbah. But how we said, Allah taba عليهم. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his name, tawab. But we don't say, Allah ta'ib. Allah tawab. We be ta'ib, repent. We repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taba, he returned. That's why we said, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Taba, anaba, thaba, raja'a, all the same meaning in Arabic. Taba, he repent. Because when you commit the sin, you'll be away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you come back to Allah, repent to Allah. Oh Allah, please, I did commit the sin. Oh Allah, I admit, I regret. Please forgive me. So you come close to Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يفرح Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala بتوبة العبد. Allah يفرح الفرح, the happiness. That's why علماء from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah يفرح, Allah get happy when the man, any Muslim repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how Allah do tawbah? When he accept your tawbah, your repentance. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide you, give you tawfiq, enable you to come back to Allah. Because some others, they go misled and commit the sin and getting worse and worse. But some others who Allah loves them, they commit the sin. But because Allah loves them, give them a shock. Then they wake up. Nafs lawama. Nafs blame themselves. Then they regret, sincere regret. They repent to Allah, ask Allah forgiveness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guarantee all of us sincere repentance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of us, forgive all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather all of us with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with Adam alayhi wa sallam and our mother Eve in Jannah and Firdaus al-A'la. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Jazakum Allah khairan. If there is any question for about say 5 minutes before the adhan, inshallah. Yes, the brother asked about how you said if there is a snake, you give them 3 days a chance. Maybe a jinn, maybe a Muslim, maybe non-Muslim. This, if they are, if the snake in your house, if you see it in your house, and the ulama, they have two opinions. Is it only in Medina? Because the jinn who became Muslims, they were in Medina. The other ulama said, no, it is anywhere. You might find jinn Muslim, right? If you find this in your house, so you will say, oh, by Allah, remember the oath of Nuh alayhi salam, Sulaiman alayhi salam. If you are Muslim, you should not really harm Muslims. That's why Aisha, when she killed the snake, and they told her, the jinn told her, you killed a Muslim jinn. She said, how come he's a Muslim and he came to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he want to see the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? How come he's a Muslim and he harmed them? He said that, no, but you were dressed. We never seen you without a dress. You know, you were, there is no aura there. Yeah, so they are, they talk like this. So if they are in the house, yes, they might be Muslim, so you give them 3 days. But if they are out, kill them straight away. And this is the Prophet ﷺ, he said that. When you see the snake, this is your enemy. Yeah? Any other question related to this or any other? Where they came, we mentioned that Adam, he came to a mountain called Booth in India, and Eve came to Jeddah, you know, Jeddah in Arabia there, and they meet each other in Arafah. Yeah, so this is anything else? MashaAllah, Jazakumullah khairan. Who's going to promise to make dua for us, all of us, huh? Everyone make dua for everyone, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jazakumullah khairan. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jazakumullah khairan. Yes. 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 Yes.
رجل انجليزي غدت لي وصل كوبي
Thank you.